Good afternoon, Roger, on a beautiful day.
Yeah, good afternoon, Richard. Yeah, it's beautiful here as well. Not a cloud on the sky. That's in West Sussex, of course. Well, it's afternoon. I'm going to be helped by Richard because there's lots and lots of different ways of doing things. And sometimes the question's asked, and there's perhaps another twist to it, or there's another little bit of a story or something like that. Or perhaps something isn't explained quite as it should be. Now, what you've got to accept is that in a normal situation, a one-to-one situation, a beekeeper asks a question, and there isn't usually an audience there. And it might help for those that are answering the questions just to add a little bit more to make it more interesting for everybody else. As I said, there's lots and lots of different ways of doing things. They're not all right, they're not all wrong. And what might work in one area, in one season, with one kind of bee, with one kind of management system, may not necessarily work in another area with different systems. So if you do ask a question, please indicate where you live, because if you're, let's say, in Kent, the answer may well be a lot different than if you're in Lincolnshire or in Connemara or somewhere like that. Now we may well ask further questions to so perhaps clarify why you're asking the question or what the situation is. So if we do, just please put the further question of further question. Can we do that on the Oh no! Can we do it on the chat facility, or the question? Would you rather have,
We can
Richard?
turn the chat facility on if you like.
I don't mind. It's up to you, really. But if we do ask a question, what would it be easier for them to? It'll probably be easier for them to do it on the chat, wouldn't
Yeah, we can enable the chat. I'll do that now.
Okay. Because we want you to get the right information. We don't want to give you the standard information that may not suit you. Now, before you start thinking, I won't ask a question because it's daft. I've got a great view that the only daft questions are those that aren't asked. So don't forget, this is a beginner's section. So, well, not really beginners, so pre-beginners, really. So don't be frightened to ask a question, whatever you do. And please remember that Richard and myself, and of course BIBBA, are here to help you. So fire away with the first one, Richard, and let's see what we've got.
Super. So the first question that I've got down here is, can you recommend back up? Oh, can't even tell. That's a good start. Can you recommend a good beginner queen introduction method?
Queen introduction method. Actually, I should be doing queen introduction as one of the topics this evening, so it might be easier to do that. But if not, what I use are what are called the puzzle cages. There's the little long flat ones. I haven't got one here, but I've got one downstairs if anybody's that interested. Yeah, the long flat ones, and I find them very good. Queen introduction isn't anywhere near as reliable as it used to be, and I don't really know the reason, Richard. I think there's something going wrong with the pheromones. I just do not know. I used to be able to introduce queens without any trouble at all. Now, all of a sudden, it's become much more difficult. So, I suggest you look in this evening, because I will be going through it then. But all I do is the puzzle cage. I've never used candy, but you can use candy if you want to, so the bees can eat it themselves. But I suggest, as a beginner, you use a cage rather than some of the other methods that you can use. And when I say a cage, I mean the not the sort of push-on cage, and those sorts of things. They're absolutely fine, but I think it'll be easier for the for a beginner to use a puzzle cage. Butler cages are okay, but they're fiddly getting queens in, and at least the puzzle cage isn't. It's nice and easy. You've got something to add to that, I'm sure.
No, I often get asked whether I remove the attendant workers or not when I introduce queens. I always have. I never have tried it with the attendants in, so I can't really say whether or not it makes a big difference. I always tend to remove them because I think that they've come from another colony. But I don't know. What do you do, Roger?
Well, you've got to think why they're in there, really. They're really in there to feed the queen. Now, I really don't think it matters. I tend to put them in because they can feed the queen straight away. If you've got to think why you're putting a queen in a cage. It's really so it gives the colony chance to talk to the queen, exchange pheromones, and that really are the main reasons. If you take a queen straight out of a colony and put another one in, they're going to, until they realise that their queen is gone, they're not going to like your queen. Now, queens, I've found, if they put them on their own and you don't feed them for an hour or so, they will die. So it really is quite quickly. So they do need feeding. And, of course, that's why why you put the attendant workers in. Now, if you've got a colony queenless for 2 hours or more and they realise they're queenless, you put another queen in there, they're going to feed them more or less straight away. But if you take one queen out and put another one straight in, they're not going to feed her straight away. So, of course, she could starve. There is another issue which sometimes concerns me, is that if you put candy in and you, hang on. Yeah. If you put candy in and you leave the attendants in, I do wonder sometimes if the attendants don't just feed the queen on the candy rather than soliciting food from the colony and then feeding the queen. So I think you've got to understand a little bit what is happening. And this is one of the reasons why I put the attendants in and I don't put candy. In fact, the odd occasion, I don't put candy in at all. I just
leave them just her in the cage with the attendants and then manually release her after.
Yeah, I usually manually release. If I've got an outhelper or something like that, where I'm not going back unless it's a special journey, then I will probably put a couple of sheets of paper over the hole and the elastic band around them all. When I have that paper, I'll put a leaf over. That's usually the way that I do it. But I will repeat that no method is 100%. And if anyone tells you they've got 100% method, that's probably because they tried it once and it worked. Because a lot of these so-called 100% methods aren't particularly reliable. There was something else that you jogged my memory about.
Did I?
Oh, right. Yes, I know. If I take attendant workers, I always take them when they're feeding for two reasons. One of which, and I'll show you this evening, when they are feeding, they arch their backs and their legs and their wings rather stick up, so you can pick them up nice and easy. There's two things with that. One, of course, is you can pick them up and you're not going to get stung. And the other thing is they're feeding, so they've got a belly full of food that they can then feed the queen until the colony realizes that it's queenless, and then of course they will solicit food from the colony. Whereas if you just took them from a comb, they may not have that much food, and they may not be able to feed the queen.
Super. We've got another beginner style question here. Can you recommend where to get a good basic honey spinner, or what kind of honey spinner to purchase?
I wouldn't initially, and I'll tell you why, because if you're an out-and-out beginner, you need to make sure that you're going to stay the distance. And there's an awful lot of beekeepers give up in the first year. That's one reason. The other reason is that quite a lot of beekeeping associations have got extractors either for hire or loan or something like that. Some beekeeping associations I know of have got two or three different kinds. Well, then you could try one out one year and perhaps another out the next year and see how you get on. Then that will help you to go and purchase your own. After 2 or 3 years, you'll then realize how many colonies you actually want. If you're going to stay down, well, let's say 10 or less, then certainly a small hand crank extractor is going to be adequate for you. But if you think, I really like this beekeeping, I think I'll get a few more colonies, then you might decide to get a bigger extractor. It's a big mistake, I think, to get a big extractor too early, because you're probably going to use it no more than 2 days a year. It's going to cost you quite a lot of money, 500 plus, something like that, for perhaps a 9-frame extractor. You're going to keep it in the shed for 360 some odd days a year, and it's going to take up quite a lot of space. So I think a honey extractor is something that I would, unless you can pick one up quite reasonably priced, I wouldn't leap in and buy. Mine is, well, I don't extract my own honey now, but my extractor is a 6-frame extractor, which I think, 20 years ago, I paid about £150 for it, new. And they're still selling them. And I think it's called a Liga, L-E-G-I-A, I think. I know Thorns sell them. I don't know how much they are in their sales. I find that exceptionally good extractor, because you can get 6 shallows or 3 deeps. Well, say no, 3 brood frames. Not many people extract 14 by 12s anyway. But I use that, and it's absolutely fine. Okay, it's a tangential extractor, so you have got to turn the frames over, but that really is no problem. A lot of beekeepers go ploughing in and they get a 9-frame radial extractor. Well, a 9-frame radial extractor for one loading is 1 superfull. So if they've got three colonies, probably 3 supers on each one, it's a little bit of a waste of time and money. But unfortunately, it's one of those things that beekeepers often treat as a status symbol rather than a working tool, really. But personally, I'd be quite happy with a hand crank extractor. But have a look, see what your local association's got first. That's why they've got them, to help out beginners. Obviously, the more experienced beekeepers, they would expect them their members to buy their own. Otherwise, of course, they clog up the system. So you've got the experienced beekeepers using the equipment, and poor beginners haven't got a chance. So, I think that's what I do. I'd hold fire a bit. Another thing is, there are some cheap ones, and if they're tall and with not a very, very wide base, they can go out of balance quite easily. So they're difficult to handle. But certainly the one I've got, the legs are splayed outwards. Have a look, have a chat to local beekeepers and see what they've got.
I definitely agree with the association thing. We've got two at our association, a radio and a tangential. And actually, one of them was donated to us by a well-known catalogue shop because two had been sent to them by accident, and they rang us up and see if we wanted it. But definitely see your local association. I'd wary against crush straining your honey. I'd definitely go and try and borrow an extractor rather than trying to scrape it out of the combs and filter it that way, which is what lots of beginners do, because the next season you haven't got any drawn combs, and the bees have got an awful lot of work to do to get back to the same situation again.
I think I would agree with that. If you've used a system where you can't extract, let's say top bar hive or something like that, I would say yes, crush it, but that is a lot of work. Extraction is obviously the simple way of doing it.
Super. So the next question then is...
Well, okay, but I think we'd better say, Richard, that if anybody's not quite happy with the question, or somebody else has got a related question, if they just... put it in all the question and answer or the chat, then we can include that, because we're here to help people.
Yeah. Nothing on the Q&A so far with that. The next one was obviously a beginner that's wanting to, had bees for a while and saying, when assessing for the best use of for a queen, what makes a good queen breeder? And what makes a good drone breeder? How can you tell which is best use for their queen?
Well, I'm assuming they're talking about from their own bees, are they? So let's say they've got two colonies. Yeah, do you reckon that?
I think that. And I think that you actually mentioned something the other day in one of your talks about you having the A, B, and C colonies. Yep. In your operation, and the ones that are in that C colony are the bees that you're going to raise drones from, because
I'll see where they're
where it's coming from.
let's take that first then. That's really a queen that herself has come from a good colony, and she would have mismated, quite honestly, at the beginner stage. I don't think I'd bother too much about that at all. It's the sort of thing you need to get involved with when you get a bit further down the line, because with a small number of colonies, you're going to struggle anyway. There's an awful lot of learning to do. And let's say queen rearing, which a simple level is no more than just using queen cells that the bees produce all summer long, but they do quite readily because of swarming or whatever. That's a simple level. If people talk about queen rearing at a talk, they never seem to talk about what the ordinary beekeeper, and no disrespect to beginners, but they're as ordinary as I am, because the bees produce them with queen cells, they don't have to go and use all these methods that these people use. It's just when you've got the opportunity, use them. So if you've got, let's just say you've only got two colonies, you're usually going to have one that you like better than the other. You just say, well, if one of them is going to is likely to produce queens of the type that you want, then raise queens from that one and perhaps requeen the other one. Not answering the question very well, is it? It's because I'm trying to make it simple, I think. Right, let's just have a look at what a beginner might want. They will probably want, they'll probably only be interested in a temper at the early stage, or good temperament. So I think as a beginner, just concentrate on that. You can get involved in all the other things a bit later on. What we got to do is get people up to speed to enjoy their beekeeping and actually want to learn more. That's how I see it.
Mm.
Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I think going on from what you were saying the other day, if you've got a colony that has got some really good traits, but you're trying to go back to something that is native, so you're wanting to try and wheedle out some of the yellow-coloured bees, you might have a queen that has got some really nice traits and is quite dark, and you could use her as a drone queen. You could use her not to raise queens from, but to raise drones from. So that's the other part of it, I suppose. But I agree. I echo the point that you make about go with temperament to start with, because if you're enjoying working your bees, then that's the main part of it, really.
Yeah, the only slight problem with that, Richard, is some of these imports, when they come in, they are very soft. You really can handle them without gloves. You can handle them without I handle everything without gloves, but you know, it's I wouldn't expect a beginner to. Although quite a lot of our beginners at Whisper Green do. They come in, they see the demonstrators don't wear gloves, and they're exactly the same. Probably about 50% of them straight away. I think there is a danger of having these soft ones that don't use smoke, because usually they're not very tough, and they're just going to fall over during the winter. And a lot of them are Italian based, and they just go through food like there's no tomorrow, and they would just plow through anything that you give them. And that, of course, is one of the reasons why we have the warnings, the annual starvation warnings, because these bees, what happens is they run short of food, so people feed them, and the queens think, "Oh, this is great. We got a nectar flow on." So they lay even more. So they eat even more food. You've got to make sure that you don't go down that road. And it's the obvious route to go, because it seems logical, but of course it's false logic.
Yeah,
it is a bit of a problem getting this message across and explaining it in a sensible way, because it does seem, when you say gentle bees, that's what people think you mean. And it's not. I've come across some of these. Well, let's put it this way: those bright yellow things that are really soft, I never ever see in the wild. And if they're not tough enough to live in the wild, then that's why they need mollycoddling.
Absolutely. Have you got a chat message, Roger?
Because
I've got a Q&A message from Margaret saying, "See chat, re-queue on extraction, please." But I can't see any.
No, I can't, no.
No, I haven't got a, Margaret, we're not quite sure what you're on with. If you either use the chat function or send the question again. Nobody's asked additional questions over what we've been speaking about. But if you, for the first time, I've enabled so that all participants can see all of the questions, and there's a little thumbs up sign underneath them, and if you click on it, it'll upvote those questions. So if we've got time at the end, you can upvote questions if you think that that one's a good one to ask.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, okay. Next one then. Okay, this one's a little bit long, so I hope you're listening, Roger. A little while back, I read a BIBBA publication, Mating in Miniature, by Bernard Mobus.
Okay, yeah.
In my opinion, there are some good ideas and suggestions in the book. For example, standardizing external dimensions of mini nukes, transporting mini nukes to manage mating stations. However, over the years, I have been a member of BIBBA, I've heard nothing more mentioned. Obviously, I'll be supporting that bit, but I think that the adoption of some of the principles in the book will be a benefit in achieving our goal. Have you any ideas about that or any?
No, quite frankly, that's been out of print for 10 years at least.
And I've never read it, so you're on your own.
Yeah. I have to say, I've forgotten a lot of what's in it, but Bernard Mobus was a brilliant beekeeper. He was actually German. I think he came over here during the war, but I'm not sure. He was one of the experts, I think, at the East of Scotland Agricultural College, Orkin Croove. But having said, having heard the point, yes, I think what we'll do is we'll have a look at that. It's kicking around somewhere, and so somebody's got a copy that we can scan. Now, there used to be a BIBBA mini nuke, which was a one frame job, and I believe it was based on an old section, but I can't be too sure. Cool, I'm talking about 30 years ago, I think. So that's before you were born, Richard, long time before you were born. yeah, if we can still get a copy of that. There may well be one in the archive. We will have a look. It may need resurrecting, because in those days, people have been quite happy to make their own. I've got a kit of a it's downstairs. I can't bring it up here. I've got a kit of the BIBBA mating nuke, because you bought it in a kit, and then there was like a glass fiber. It was called a cozy that went over the top of it. From memory, I don't think it was that successful. And I don't think it was successful because there was only one frame in it. But we're going to have to resurrect that.
There was a BIBBA mating nuke, mini mating nuke.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. I've got one. And I know who's got another one. Mine isn't made up. Mine's in a still in the kit form. You just bought it a little flat pack like you do with a brew chamber. Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, but actually, now we the questioners mentioned it, then we'll have a look at that again. Or perhaps the question, if they've got one, then perhaps they can do an article on it for a BM. Especially if they've used them, because these things, they tend to get out of use, and sometimes it's easier to buy something that say 15 quid than it is to make something.
Excellent. Peter Jenkins, going back to selecting breeding stock, says, how about selecting bees that survive the winter without constant feeding? If they don't survive the winter, they're all dead in the spring anyway.
Yeah, that's right. Self-selection, that, isn't it? Yeah, actually, I agree with him. The problem with that approach from a beginner's point of view is if you lose bees, it's quite a heavy loss. It's okay for Peter and myself to say, well, okay, if they eat too much, then hard luck, but I would always feed them, get them to the winter, and then requeen in the spring. But of course, a beginner hasn't really got that experience to be able to do that.
Margaret's got back to us. She's looking for tips on extraction and storage of honey from oilseed rape.
Oh, right. Storing of honey, that's another thing that I should be touching on later. So if you can come in at 7:30, Margaret, then please do. Yeah, very briefly, as I said, I don't manage my own honey. Somebody else does that. Now they take it and then pay me for it. But what I used to do is the 30-pound buckets. Instead of putting the honey straight in, which I find messy because you've still got to clean it out, and if the lid isn't airtight, and they may not be airtight, then air can get in. Of course, you can get fermentation. So what I do is get a plastic bag, food grade plastic bag, as a liner. Put it into the bucket. Bring it back over the top. Fill the bucket up, and then use one of these plastic wire twist ties. You know, there's like a piece of paper with a wire going through. Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Squeeze all the air out of it, and then just wrap this round, and that can be left airtight. And I've never ever had a problem with those. You can get 30 pound in the buckets, no trouble at all. And when you warm them up, then all you do is just tip the honey out, grab hold of the corner of the bag like that, and then through your hand, well, can't quite do it, but through your hand, wipe all the honey out, and there's virtually no honey left in there. There's less than if you put it in the bucket, and then sadly you put the bag in the waste bin, which is the one sort of minus side of it, but. I guess it's recyclable plastic. That's what I do, and that will keep for some time. Now, oilseed rape honey is a little bit, let's say, different. The good thing about it is that it granulates quickly. Once it's granulated, then you can stack the buckets up as high as you like. If the honey stays liquid, I wouldn't stack any more than two, possibly three high. I haven't had the problem, but I know somebody else who did, and the bottom, the buckets in the bottom row just split because of the weight that's on the top. And you need to be careful. Now you can use oilseed rape for creaming, soft set, call it what you like. We tend to call it soft set these days because people don't understand what creaming is, and it's really good for that because it's a fine crystal, and you can put some of that in amongst other honey that perhaps wouldn't granulate very quickly, and it just sets quite quickly. And if Peter Jenkins is still listening, I suspect that's what he does, because I know he goes to oilseed rape. He's better explained to people. Peter Jenkins is up in the Welsh Hills where there's no oilseed rape, and he takes his bees 40, 50 miles to Pembroke. Might be a bit further than that. I don't know, but where there's oilseed rape. So, of course, he's getting the oilseed rape, he's bringing that back. And I guess, but I don't know, he uses that for seeding his soft set honey.
Margaret says granulation question mark. I wonder if she's meaning in the comb or in the bucket, or I would have thought she means in the comb. With odds of it, you need to make sure you get them off as soon as they start capping them.
Yeah, that's right. if you keep your eyes on the fields, as soon as they turn sort of predominantly green, you've got to get it off. But then having got it off, you've got to be careful as well, because if you use clearer boards, depending on where you are, we're still talking sometimes in May, you can still get frosts. So these supers with full of oilseed rape honey, you get a cold night and it can quicken up the granulation. When you get the supers off, get them into a warm room or a warm place as quickly as you can. I know of people do all sorts of things, like put a brew box or a couple of brew boxes on the floor, empty ones, or you could do it with supers, I suppose. Then put stack the supers on top of that and put something like a low wattage light bulb underneath, or some sort of heat source. You don't want to be too much because you end up melting the wax. Just to keep it warm. Now, that will do two things. One is that it will keep the combs warm so that it will retard granulation. And the other thing is it will extract an awful lot quicker too.
Excellent.
Well, we're not sure if we've answered the question, because
yeah, she's I haven't got any further comments, so I presume that we've covered that.
Either that or a border. No, I know what it was. I mentioned Peter Jenkins.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even if nobody knows him, well, they've heard of him, and they.
Yeah, we're surrounded by oilseed rape, so we have to deal with this every year. I've actually got an old brood box that's got a black, it's like a heating lamp for a reptile that's in there with a controller.
Oh, right, yeah, okay.
Supers on the top of and put the temperature probe further up and it's got a computer fan to blow the warm air upwards and round. But yeah, right. just to keep them while I'm getting ready for extraction.
I'm not an electrician, but I understand these days that that you're not allowed to do things like that yourself unless you've got certificates. But
I think you've got to be a competent person. So
right.
I've got somebody else to do it for me.
Right, okay. You got out of that quite well, bearing in mind this is recorded, yeah.
Yeah. I think that's the rule. If it's you have to be a competent person. Yeah, get an electrician to check it if you're unsure.
Yeah.
Let's move on. Jenny says, is it possible to do a colony split and not move the new colony 3 miles away? We're in Gloucestershire and have just got one colony in our second year with them, and we would like to get up to two colonies this year. We have room for three. We've been advised that we need to move the new colony 3 miles away, but if we can avoid that, then that would be preferred.
Right. Okay. There's lots of different ways of doing it. With only one colony, you could actually do it later in the season. You could do it. Oh, hang on. Yeah. This is where we could do with help from the person. If they want a little bit of honey, and they've got oilseed rape, then what they could do is let the colony go until they get the oilseed rape, extract that, and then they could split the colony probably in June, and it won't be that much of a problem. Now, if you split the colony, I was going to include that this evening, but I just haven't got space. If you split the colony, right, I don't know if you're going to be able to. Right, split the colony where it is into two halves, but move the two halves so you're sort of covering the entrance, but leave a gap of about a foot, something like that, or perhaps a shade more, so that when the bees come back, they equal out between the two new colony. Well, one's effectively the original, and the other one is
So you've split the frames into two brood boxes.
Into two brood boxes, but leave the two only with a 12, 18 inches between. So the bees come back and then they equal about the new hives. Now, what you'll find is if one's got the
queen
in, those bees will probably fan more at the entrance and they will draw more bees to that. So move that one. If that happens, move it 4, 5, 6 feet away, a couple of meters away for a short while, and then they should even out. That's one thing you could do. What you could also do is an artificial swarm without having the queen cells. And instead of what you can do is take the queen with the little bit that, you know, the, sorry, let me just think about this. Right. If you've got queen cells put up, you can do an artificial swarm. That will. I'm sorry, but I'm trying to think of a method that's simple for beginners, because this is a beginner's section. You could do an artificial swarm. That would be one way of doing it. You could also do a two frame nuke, like I have described before. It's on Cushman's website, and we've also got a webinar on it. If you put the two-frame nuke in the position of the parent colony, move the parent colony away, that is effectively the same as an artificial swarm. But in that case, I think what I'd do is put the queen with the two-frame nuke, which I don't normally do, and then let the parent colony raise queen cells, and then use one of those. Although they've lost their flying bees, they should be absolutely fine for raising queen cells. So it's just a simple two-frame nuke.
Yeah, that's what I was got in mind, because then in your original colony where there's no queen now, you've got lots of nurse bees there that are going to be able to feed any queen cells.
Feed the queen cells, yeah.
And then just monitor the weather just in case that colony hasn't got enough food. Obviously, if it's heavy enough and it's got some frames of honey, it'll be all right. But because it's lost its flying bees, you just don't want it to starve.
No, that's right. Yeah, this is a little bit of a problem for the for beginners. But what else you could do is once you've taken the supers off and you've got yourself some honey, just do a straight split, what the Americans call a walkaway split. But leave the two frame nuke. Is that you put that up?
Yeah, it's just a link. Yeah.
Yeah. But a straight split will be about the same as the a two frame nuke.
Yeah. I do what Peter Jenkins does. I split when the colonies come back from the oilseed rape. When the oilseed rape's finished flowering, then I start to make some splits and raise some queens, because we've got a bit of a gap then after the oilseed rape's finished, and it's a good time to split bees.
Yeah. Do you take your bees to heather?
I don't, no.
Oh, right, okay.
It's not something I've done.
So you haven't got a later crop then?
No. I should do, because I live in Yorkshire and I'm daft not to, but...
Okay, right. What we've done, I think, is... what I've done is completely confused the listeners. So probably the simplest way is effectively a... if you've got queen cells, is to just do an artificial swarm. Or in fact, any method of swarm control will be okay. But an artificial swarm is the one that everybody knows, and that will give you what you want. You could also make up a two-frame nuke, as I've described, but instead of leaving the queen with the original colony, put the queen with the two-frame nuke on the parent stand and move the parent colony away, or just do a straight split. If you're not worried about secondary crop, just do a straight split. But if you do that, I would move the queen away, and you can do it on a smaller a smaller nuke. So perhaps you leave 5, 6, 7 frames on the parent site, leaving them to produce themselves a queen, which they should do without any problem. You need to make sure, I think, that your colony is actually strong. If you do it in a weak colony, I think you might have a nutrition problem for the brood.
Jenny says, so the two frame nuke would have the queen in it, and there would be brood. And where would the brood, where the brood box was?
Yep.
And move the original colony, original brood box about a foot away.
You can go further than that if you like. Yeah. That could go onto the new site.
And do any of this in about June time?
That's if she wants honey. She could have the early crop, say.
Yeah. Why would we have to move it 3 miles away? What purpose does that serve? I think that's from the advice that she's got.
Right. Well, which is reasonably sound advice, because of course you aren't running the risk of the bees flying back to the original position. If you move them away 3 miles, I would do it for some time. In fact, Peter Jenkins and myself had this discussion. This thing about bees living 6 weeks, some of them might, but an awful lot of them don't. And Peter, exactly the same as me, has moved bees away and then moved them back 6 weeks later. And they still go to where they came from. I think bees, well, Peter does as well, and he's been keeping bees same length of time as me, both over 50 years. Some of these things that you read in books is just not how it is in the real world. But yes, was it Margaret that was asked the question?
No, that was Jenny.
Oh right, okay.
Oh, she was told that they were only needed to move the colony for 3 okay. For a week.
Oh, no. 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 Difficult to criticise anyone, but if somebody's telling you that, they're probably not a very experienced beekeeper themselves. No. No. But it may be that some of it was misinterpretation. I don't know. But you can do it within your own apiary without too much of too much of a problem.
Yeah. Linda wants to just nip back to the oilseed rape question. She says, should the frames be washed so that none remains as we go into the summer?
No, the bees will clean them out. Don't store, don't store combs, what we call wet, so straight out of the extractor. That used to be a trick the old beekeepers did, because it was felt that it discouraged a greater wax moth. Personally, I don't think it did, but it just made everything ferment and made it stink horrible. No, the bees will actually clean it out okay.
Yeah. Julie says, we let our bees draw a drone frame 2 days ago. We found 24 cell queen cells on it. Resolved queen cell problems, but one wondered if it's common to get queen cells on drone cells. Drone comb.
On drone comb. If the bees build cell cups, they don't seem to mind too much where they build them. It's usually on worker comb or adjacent to worker comb. I'd be a bit concerned about that. I wonder if they've got a drone layer.
And whether or not the workers have tried to draw queen cells out on drone.
Well, I wonder why they're drawing queen cells for a start.
There's and 24 as well.
Well, 24 is either going to be emergency or swarm. Now, very often bees that are queenless and have been queenless for some time and get either a drone laying or a laying worker or a drone laying queen. And when I say queenless, I mean fertile queen. They will very often produce what look like queen cells on with drones inside, but really only a small number, like sort of three or four, perhaps, not the large numbers. So from what is it, Linda?
Yes.
Yeah, from what Linda's said.
Julie.
Oh, Julie, right. Okay. Yeah, from what she says, it seems to me as if they are genuine swarm cells, but on drone comb doesn't make sense.
No.
Well, drone comb I normally put on the edge of the box anyway. I'd need to either look at the photographs, some photographs, or the colony, unless somebody is being mistaken. Are they actually queen cells or are they drone cells? Because if they're a new beekeeper, they might not have seen drone cells.
Yeah. Just bobbing back to Jenny and splitting her hive, she says, can we get away with leaving the old and the new in the same garden the entire time?
Oh, yeah.
If you're doing what Roger said and have the queen in the original spot, the old box in a new position will start, the bees that emerge will start flying and returning to that new
spot. And they'll get stronger. And what will happen is, in probably a couple of days, you'd hardly know that they've been moved. Because what they do is they the colony shunts everything forward, so they're back into balance fairly quickly.
Yeah,
you always get this if you move a colony.
Richard from the West Midlands says he's been beekeeping for 1 year. Brood box is full, plenty of stores in there, and the bees are starting building comb under the frames, and the queen is laying in there. Worried about the risk of swarm due to lack of space, but don't want to go onto brood and a half. What should I do?
Right. So he's got a brew chamber, presumably with supers, or don't you know?
Doesn't say whether he's got supers on, because that was the thing I was going to say. Make sure you've got some supers on there to give them space to move into and start storing any income. It doesn't say.
It depends what sort of queen they've got. If it's a very prolific queen, then yes, he's going to have to go probably double brood, I would have thought. I personally don't like multiple brood chambers at the best of times. But if they're the sort of bees he's got, then that's what he's got to go for. brood and a half. I hope I don't upset anybody, but personally, I think it's one of the worst things for a beekeeping, because you've got brood on two sizes of frames. Now, some people say, "Oh yes, I can manage it," but you don't get commercial beekeepers with brood on brood and a half, or not with any great numbers anyway. Now, I've got absolutely no problem, if you want to use multiple brood chambers, of using two or three supers, if that's indeed what you want to do. And there's probably a bit of mileage in that, really, especially if you're a little bit on the side of struggling to lift, because then you've only got small frames. I wouldn't argue with that at all. But going on two different sizes of frames is always proved a problem, as far as I can see. Yeah.
Yeah, it's difficult to give him any firm advice, because we don't know whether or not he's got supers on there already.
And what sort of bees he's got too.
Yeah.
Wait just a minute. He's got wait a minute. He's got comb underneath the frames.
Yeah.
Right.
He must have a deep floor on.
He's got a deep floor, yeah. If he has a shallow floor, that doesn't happen. And to the best of my knowledge, all open mesh floors are deep, or the commercial ones are deep. My own, that I make myself, they are shallows, and I just don't get the problem underneath. Now, when you get comb underneath, I did this in one of the early ones. When you get comb underneath the frame, it's because the gap between the bottom of the frame and the top of the floor is too big for the bees to climb up. So they build comb under there. there are problems with that, because very often it's drone, which is wider than the a worker above. But worse still, bees tend to use it for building queen cells in. So you can miss queen cells, thinking that missed them. You know, you've viewed them on the surface of the comb, and they're down there. And of course, out comes the swarm. And they're not mine, because I looked 2 days ago and I got rid of all the queen cells. Oh no, you didn't, because I probably put one horizontal. And you only need one queen cell for swarm to go out. Right. So that might be why the bees are doing that. Right. But they're only going to do it. That's the one area where they probably do it, where they build comb when they don't actually need it for the queen to lay in. Right at this moment, if there's brood on all 11 frames, I would say it's quite a prolific queen, and you either need to change a queen for something that is more suitable locally, or put on multiple boxes. But the poor chap's only been keeping bees a year. It depends where he got them from. I mean, if he bought a Buckfast or Italian or something like that, then yes, they're just going to explode. Well, I say Buckfast, they're so variable, it's difficult to say what they're like. I've seen some Buckfasts that actually aren't that prolific, but others, they just.
I love the slide that you put up about Buckfast with all the different Buckfast queens, and they're all different from all different suppliers.
Yeah,
yeah, they're all Buckfast the same.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the problem with Buckfast is there's no actual definition for them. And you get a Greek Buckfast, it's different than a German one, which is different than a French one, which is different than a Danish one, which is different than an American one. You know, genetically, they're different. And sometimes I'll go to places and get shown Buckfast. And one chap bought four queens from one source, and look at the queens, and they're all different colours, and so are the offspring. You know, you can't say what they are, really, unless you get them from a really top-notch supplier who does take care in what they supply. They could be very variable. But anyway, we're not here to knock Buckfast, so we're here to help the gentleman from Warwickshire.
Yeah.
It might help if we knew if he knows what bees they are. I mean, if it's something he just got locally, then they're likely to be different than if he bought them as a nucleus from a supplier. That might give us some help.
Yeah. Yeah, he hasn't said anything. So, Rob says, and I know exactly what you're going to say to start with here. Rob says, how much food should there be in a hive at all times to ensure the bees don't starve?
Yeah, you're right. What do you want to answer it then?
Well, I was just going to say, it depends how prolific your bees are.
It depends on, and also the time of year, how much brood there is. But I always say to people that if you've got the equivalent of one frame of food, that's going to last most colonies getting on for a week. So if perhaps you've got, say, an out apiary, and you've got you've had some bad weather, let's say, and the bees haven't brought anything in, if they've got equivalent of a frame of food, that should last them for about a week.
Are you counting the semicircle or the rainbow of shape of food that you have around your brood?
I add a lot up together.
A total.
Then you've got sort of 4 or 5 pound of honey. But on the other hand, some colonies, you get really strong ones, they go through the best part of a super in a week.
Some bees that just turn every bit of food into brood, don't they?
Yeah.
So you've really got to know what kind of bees you've got, which isn't a good answer for a beginner, but it's...
No, it isn't. But of course, for a beginner just buys bees. And they might go to a catalogue and they say, this is wonderful, and that's not very good. Don't have that. Have these, and you know, they do use up an awful lot more food, some of them, than others do. It's a sort of question that you'd expect beginners to ask, because it's a logical sort of question, but it's exactly the same as asking how much food a dog needs. I mean, an Alsatian is going to eat more than a Chihuahua will. It's as simple as that. And it's not just the bees that are hungry or that eat. In fact, adult bees don't really eat that much compared to brood. Brood is incredibly hungry, like very hungry. So if you've got a lot of brood in the colony that's young and is being fed, not sealed brood obviously doesn't need, an older unsealed brood doesn't need feeding, young brood does, and sort of first 5 days of being a larva, they get through a huge amount. Well, it's the same as I keep saying to people: if colony's strong enough, to fill a super is strong enough to eat it.
Yeah. Yemi says, I had to do a split this month with several sealed queen cells. I'm worried that the virgin queen will swarm. How can I prevent this?
It depends how far down the road they've got. presumably, none of the queens have emerged yet. If they've done a split, reduce queen cells to one, just one. I'll give them the reasons for that.
It sounds like that he hasn't. If he's worried that a virgin is going to swarm,
right? Then reduce to one queen cell. Don't forget that if you do that, you'll end up with emergency cells, and depending on the timing, you can have emergency cells sealed within probably 3 days. So if you remove the queen cells, if they haven't emerged within 3 days, you need to go back and cut out the emergency cells. Otherwise, what may happen if the colony is strong enough, they will swarm with the queen that emerges, leaving the one behind from the emergency cell.
Yeah, he's in Reading, and he says, I added a super with foundation as well to force the bees to stay.
Yeah, no, that if they're strong enough and the weather is kind enough, leaving one more than one queen cell can end up with another swarm and swarming again.
Yeah,
don't rely on it. Hang on, you're supposed to be answering some of these.
Well, I can't get a word in edgeways.
Okay, all right. Dogs, walkies.
What is the most obvious sign that the bees are going to swarm?
Oh, as far as the beekeeper is concerned, it's obviously queen cells. Yeah, as soon as they start putting up swarm cells, during the summer, of course, they can put up supersedure cells, which they will actually swarm on if the colony's strong enough. But it's
another reason why you need to reduce it to one.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very definitely queen cells. And this, of course, is why you need to inspect regularly. either 7 or 14 days, but I've gone through that and some of the other webinars. Certainly 7 days. If you've got unclipped queens, you really need to go through every 7 days.
Presence of drone brood?
Oh, as far as the beginner is concerned, don't even worry about that. Yeah. You know, if there's queen cells there, then that's really what they've got to look at. What we've got to make sure is that we don't make it too complicated for beginners.
Mm-hmm. Sharon says, could you explain the process of the queen, her maiden flight after she's mated with drones? What happens next? Does she go back into the hive, to the colony? She's a bit confused what happens after her flight.
Well, yeah, she goes back in, and apparently, I've never seen it happen. In fact, I've only ever seen a mating sign on one occasion, and I've never actually seen a queen come back from a mating flight, which seems surprising. But on the other hand, I've lived out in the country all my life, and I've only ever seen two drone assemblies. So, and I do a lot of walking. You know, you don't always see these things. But as I understand it, the worker bees remove the mating sign, and it takes about 3 days for the sperm to migrate into the spermatheca. And then after 3 days, after mating, the queen will normally start laying. That's as I understand it, and that's sort of borne out by what happens in the apiary, really.
Yeah, and she goes on several mating flights. It's not just one, depending.
She could do, but again, until we can get this tracking sorted out, which is I think just around the corner, I'm pretty certain it's still quite a lot of guesswork, conjecture, call it what you like. I know it's easy enough to believe what the scientists say, but I don't think it's probably quite as cut and dried as it's made out to be. My guess is there's quite a bit more going on than we actually know.
Yeah. Rob says, would Roger be prepared to give a talk on mini nukes as per the Atkinson / Mobis, or perhaps have another speaker talk on the minimum size hive to make queens as part of the series?
We could do. Don't forget, John Getty did one on Abadeus a few weeks ago. Certainly at this level, beginner's level, I wouldn't even entertain it. Mini nukes are problematic. There's a lot of learning to be done, or in my experience, there's a lot of learning to be done, and I think you're probably much better learning by being under the wing of somebody who does use mini nukes. Personally, I wouldn't use them for small numbers. I think I've written somewhere that if you want less than six queens, I wouldn't bother. And I use them on a continual basis. So it's one queen out and a queen cell in. For that point of view, you need a succession of queen cells. Now, somebody mentioned Atkinson. I'm assuming they mean John Atkinson. And John Atkinson tried to persevere with what he called a micro nuke, which is a very small nuke. But what he found was that they couldn't create enough heat in there. Or when I spoke to him, this is what he thought was happening. They couldn't create enough warmth for the sperm to migrate into the spermatheca. That's why they failed. There's absolutely no need for the ordinary beekeeper to bother with anything like that. And I do see people come out of the various sales with one mini nuke under their arm. And they're obviously sold these things, telling that and being told, oh, all you need is a couple of bees and a queen cell, and hey, presto, you've got a queen. It is not that easy. And I've been the auctioneer of West Sussex beekeeping auction, I'm told, for over 30 years now. In fact, I've been to every one apart from the ones that were called off by COVID, and they started in 1975, I think. So I've been to every one. And there are some mini nukes that I've discreetly marked, and they're what I call the boomerang lots. They keep coming back because people buy them, and very often they pay more than what you can pay new for them. They take them home and they think, oh, raise a few queens. And they fail, and they bring them back, not necessarily the following year, but the year after that. And they just keep coming back, and I've sold them, I don't know, four, five, might even be six times. Right, what is the problem with mini nukes? Well, I better explain what they are first. They're little polystyrene, well, not always polystyrene, but the commercial ones are polystyrene, and they're... you get small frames in that are only 100 millimeters square-ish, the different shapes, different sizes. And the purpose of them is to make queens in. Now, if you are a queen producer, absolutely fine. No problem. People like John Getty, and I think he said he raises about 400 queens a year. Absolutely fine. But if you've only got half a dozen colonies or less, I wouldn't even consider it. Because there are other ways of raising queens that are more reliable. What are the problems with them? Well, the simple ones are they do abscond, and for all sorts of reasons. They've abscond because there's not enough bees in it. Too many bees. When you set them up, if you haven't got any brood in there, there's nothing really to hold them. So out they go. If you get a week of different weather can make quite a lot of difference, because if there's no food coming in, they can starve. If there is a nectar flow on, they can absolutely pack out the little box. And on many occasions, I've had them going into the feeder, building comb in the feeder. So they do need managing. Oh, quite honestly, at this level, which is, you know, the sort of beginner's level, I wouldn't even entertain them, wouldn't even consider them. Was that a long way of saying that?
No, that's good. I mean, I built some of my own two frame boxes that are two boxes together, so they've got a bit of a division board in between. Yeah. And that, I find those quite successful, because you only need a smaller number of bees to be able to do it, but it's not like a mini newt, like you've said, it that causes problems. But a newt box, if you're a beginner, just a newt box is fine.
In fact, that is what I prefer. And last year I produced 150 queens, and I have to say I prefer the newt, especially for a beekeeping association, because you can produce newts for your beginners as well. And you've also got local queens. You know, they're absolutely fine.
Next question is Angela. Cleaning frames annually. She uses a Burco boiler, but it's a bit too short and the frames have to be flipped. Do you know of a boiler that would work more efficiently?
No, I don't. I don't do it myself. So I really don't know. What you're going to have to do is ask locally, I think. I've never done that.